Writer. Public speaker. A judge on The Wolf of Wall Street.
Bella said at $10 million.
And a diehard New Yorker. Fran Lebowitz is famous for her wits and her super sarcastic, cutthroat cultural criticism in her writing and mostly in her public speaking. When she was young, she worked at a lot of jobs, and she was even once a cab driver in New York City.
You were a cab driver. Were you a good cab driver?
I don't want to brag. I was an excellent, I was in fact a superb cab driver. I did not like driving a cab, I have to say. I did not find it colorful, interesting, or picturesque. I learned nothing from it, and I hope I never have one of those jobs again.
She then met Andy Warhol and was hired to be the columnist for the Interview magazine.
Can you speak a bit about your experience writing for Interview magazine and Andy Warhol?
I was very young when I started working for Interview. I was like 20 years old. And I wrote for Interview for like 11 years. I never got along with Andy. He's done much better since he died. How do I know this? Because I sold all my Warhols 2 weeks before he died.
And now she's the author of 2 bestsellers, and she's the subject of 2 Martin Scorsese's documentaries.
How did you two meet?
Oh, how did we meet?
Do you want to tell her?
Do we know?
No.
No.
To understand how to be a writer, and more importantly, a funny, a witty writer, Fran knows that you have to pay your dues first by, well, knowing something.
Writers have to know things. You know, they have to know things about life. You know, musicians don't. That's why there's musical prodigies. You know, there was Mozart. There's no equivalent to Mozart in writing.
Because even if you were that innately talented, you would still have to know something to write it down. You know, and so in fields where you have to know something, there are no child prodigies. Hence the child actor field where you actually are not well served by knowing anything.
You may or may not learn more things about writing as you get older. Some people don't. Some people are fully formed with their first book. You see that, like with Philip Roth, you see that. You know, they have that voice right away. Some people specialize in youthful things in writing. Of course, they get worse. If you're going to specialize in youth, you know, you're going to get worse.
And in order to know something, read. Read as much as possible.
Do you read a lot of new writers? Do you read a lot of young writers?
I do.
Do you read a lot?
I read a lot, yes. I read, it's mostly what I do, is read. Basically, I'm a bookworm.
How do you get on to the books that you read, knowing there's even if you just focused on the good ones, there's more than you could possibly read?
I've always had, although it becomes harder and harder, many friends older than me who say, what, you haven't read this? Then they tell me, and I read it. Also, I used to browse around bookstores, but there are fewer and fewer of them. But it's just something I think about all the time. And if someone recommends a book, and I think that would be a good recommendation, I buy the book.
And by reading a wide selection of books, you will start to develop your own individual voice.
When my first book came out, I was 27. There were no people my age who had books out. That is a generational thing, because people my age, they don't want to be writers. People my age wanted to be musicians or filmmakers. So all the people I know who were artists of one sort or the other, that was the thing. So I had like no contemporaries, you know? And it looked like it was dying out. That's why people should stop saying, this is the end of that, you don't know what's gonna happen. You know, this is the end of that, this is it. You know, when my first book was published, the publisher said, I don't, you know, this book isn't gonna sell because it's not since the 1920s has a book of comic essays sold. And even though I was a kid, I said, so what? And really, I would say that now, so what? You know, that here's what happens. One comes out and sells. There's a million of them.
One of Fran's most signature humor is her extremely incisive criticism of day-to-day life. Observation is key. So put down your phone and start looking at the people around you. What are their stories?
I do not have a cell phone. I do not have a BlackBerry. I do not have computer, or any of these things. A microwave oven, whatever these things, all of which seem like the same thing to me, by the way. You know, like if you tell me, well, the microwave oven, can you text on that? Yes, I would believe you. Okay, so I have none of these machines, which is what allows people to not be wherever they are. Okay, but since I don't have them and I'm forced to be where I am all the time, which is why I'm noticing what other people are doing. Okay, most people aren't noticing where they are because they're not really any place. They're If you are like doing this, that's where you are. I don't care where you're doing it, that's where you are. So the experience of the street, say in New York, which I have commonly, you know, every day, I'm one of the very few people in the street having the experience of the street.
Most people are on their phones, a few people are reading, but that's never been me. You know, I'm sitting there and I'm just looking at my fellow man. And this is, most of the time, excessively interesting. Too interesting. I saw a kid riding a bike down 7th Avenue. He was with one hand texting, with the other hand eating a piece of pizza, and he was driving the bike with his elbows. Oh. He had his elbows on the thing. Oh. And of course he almost ran me over. Not that he noticed. That's why I noticed him. And I thought, I am a person who believes every day I have a very high chance of being killed crossing the street. This is a person who believes nothing will ever happen to him. And it's an astonishment to me that every day, tens of thousands of people aren't slaughtered in the streets of New York. No, the only person looking where she's going is me. I am the one person in the whole city who is watching where I'm going. And sometimes, like, I bumped into someone because they were, like, not paying attention, and I just thought I'm gonna let them walk right into me. And they looked up, like, annoyed, and I said, other people in a hotel lobby, isn't that astonishing?
And after some time of intentional people watching, in order to make your writing funny, you have to know what funny actually is, what wit is.
When I read things you've written, there's something in there that is, I can distinguish by sound, but not by definition, which is the difference between wit and the comic or the humorous in writers. What do you think that difference is?
Niceness.
Niceness?
I mean, or what people call, like, you know, warmth.
Wit.
No, comedy.
Ah, oh, I see.
Like, we have a lot of comedians.
Yeah.
Because people like comedians. People like comedians because comedians usually make fun of someone other than the person they're talking to. You know, or if they directly make fun of that person, it's in a very insulting, vulgar way. But in writing, wit is something, it's cold. It has to be cold. You know, wit is judgment.
Oscar Wilde type coldness.
Yeah, people say Oscar Wilde type like there's like a lot of other people like
there's
Oscar Wilde.
One. That's true. Yeah. True.
And it's also usually short. Mm-hmm. You know, usually can't be dragged out to the length of a feature film. And also, it has a lot of assumption to it, which is not a thing Americans like. They don't want you to assume, presume, or judge. That's elite.
But wit is a talent. Humor is a talent. If you know that you're funny, go for it. And if not, know when to stop.
How can one learn sense of humor?
How can you acquire a sense of humor? The same way you can acquire height.
Yeah. Where do you think your sense of humor comes from? Is it more nature or nurture?
Well, I would say nature because there wasn't that much nurture of it, let me assure you. And my mother said to me when I got to be like 12 or something like that, don't be funny around boys. Boys do not like funny girls. Unfortunately, she was wrong. So I knew what talent was because I was very aware of the lack of it in myself. When I was very little, there was a point I wanted to be an artist, and I thought, why did you decide not to? And then I thought, you decided not to be an artist too pleasurable, Fran. It's like when people say, why are Jews not allowed to eat bacon? And I always say, too delicious. The main thing writers need, or painters, or, you know, any other kind of artist, is talent. You cannot buy it. You cannot learn it. You know, you cannot inherit it. You can't. It's not genetic, okay? It is just like sprinkled, like, you know, sand around the world. And it is probably the reason why people are always, especially in this country, looking for explanations for success of a book, or I mean, when I say success, I don't mean commercial mm-hmm. success, other than talent.
But always allow yourselves to make mistakes. There's no shame in trying.
If I knew now the things I knew that I know now when I was young, I would have made these mistakes. But I have really bad news for people. You continue to make mistakes. You continue to make mistakes. And you have less excuse because it's very rare that you have the opportunity when you're older to make a new mistake.
So instead you find like, I can't believe I made this mistake again. Because I knew not to make. The first time I didn't know. And so, you know, you give yourself a pass. But then you think, you know, really, let's face it, this is like the 16th time I've made the same mistake.
And when you try and fail enough times, you will start to hate writing. But know that you don't actually have to love writing to be a writer. Because most writers don't. They just simply don't. Well, most good writers don't.
I loved to write when I was a child. I loved to write until the very first time I got an assignment to write for money. And then I hated to write. I have known, I would say, only one really, really good writer in my life who loves to write. Only one. Loves to write. Most people who love to write are horrible writers. So of course they love to write. I love to sing, by the way. I'm a horrible singer. So if you love to do something that you're really bad at, that's not surprising.
Once I asked you, because you often express how much you like to write, not a thing writers frequently say. And I asked you why you like to write so much, and you said, because otherwise I'm stuck with life.
Well, I have to say that after I finished the first book I wrote, The Bluest Eye, there was a period of melancholy that was very profound. And I can anticipate that feeling at the close of a novel, and at the close of the last revision, that constant picking over and picking over and making sure it's this word and not that word. But it's true. Stuck with life may be a little strong, Fran, but it's certainly...
I'm just quoting you accurately.
Writing is a lifelong journey. Most writers didn't write their masterpieces until they are in their 50s. Understand that you will get better over time.
To require someone to turn out masterpieces is psychotic. You know, I mean, you know, to say things like, Fitzgerald, I only want one great book. You know, I mean, really? And how many do most people write? You know, most writers write a million books, don't write even one good book. You know, so I'm not saying that it's not an incredibly valuable thing to have done. I mean, Toni Morrison's new book, you know, is, I think, her best book. You know, she's 76. I think there's an idea that has to do really with people's idea of artists that has nothing at all to do with art, but just people's, a romantic idea of the artist. So a romantic idea of the artist has to be young, because no one has a romantic idea of an old person. I was interested in older people. I always had friends much older than me. I had friends so much older than me that by the time I was 40, many of my closest friends have died of old age already. But it was because they were older than me. In other words, because they could teach me something, you know, but not because I thought they were gonna do the new thing. That was my job. You know, that's how the work used to be split up.
Hi everyone, I'm Peng Hei-Wang, the creator of The Human Condition. Thank you for watching this video. The Human Condition is a channel dedicated to helping you, our creative humans, to reach your personal goals by studying the great artists and thinkers in the world. And each month we pick up one great human and a companion piece like a classic film or a book to study. And this month we picked the always funny Fran Lebowitz. And her book of essays, A Fran Lebowitz Reader, for the first month of 2022. So like and subscribe for more content, and tell us your favorite one-liners from the book. And we'll see you next week.